music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
It is my pleasure and honor to have as my guest today the great American pianist Constance Keene. And great she is, because this is a pianist that has color, imagination, and she plays the romantic repertory, especially in the most heavenly way, even though we'll begin today with part of her Bach album. Bach is a composer that has been dear to her, as I think all pianists. Bach is the spiritual and technical bread and butter of music. Constance, how are you?
I'm fine and very happy to be here.
Thank you. You have always been a pianist that has concentrated on, it seems, difficult music. Is this true?
Well, I think it's difficult to play everything. And on some of my records, you know, I play some works that are considered simple, like a couple of songs without words. But let's face it, to make a melodic line sing is just as hard as it is to play a piece of the utmost virtuosity.
But even in the pieces of utmost virtuosity, such as some of the Rachmaninoff preludes, singing is your first element that you're thinking of, I think.
Well, that's my first consideration, to communicate, and not to communicate only through how fast or loud one plays.
Yes, you have an album, and I would like to read what Arthur Rubinstein has said of this album, the 24 preludes of Rachmaninoff, because they are my favorite Rachmaninoff. They're just absolutely wonderful in their sweep, and yet their understatement. As you would say, they're not schmaltzy. I cannot imagine anybody, including Rachmaninoff himself, playing the preludes more beautifully. I was completely flabbergasted by the fantastic sweep, color, tone, and last but not least, the incredible technique. So I think that the great Rubinstein says it all there about this recording. Later we'll hear from this recording. Can you tell me about the album's life? Does it still exist in print?
Well, the album is now coming out in its fourth version. I don't mean that I've recorded it four times, but on its fourth label. I had originally done it for Cap, and Cap went out of the classical business when that was to be released.
Oh.
So that was a nightmare for me, you can imagine, after doing all of that work and putting them all on tape. And I myself bought the tapes back from Cap and had it issued, and that was the first version. I've now forgotten the label, isn't that awful, but that was some time ago. And then Phillips asked to bring them out, and that was the second version. Then Phillips stopped releasing them because the World Series was no longer in existence with Phillips, and since they were my tapes, I was free to utilize the tapes again. And then Laurel Protown brought them out, and now we've sold out all of that issue, and now they're coming out on Protown label, and you will be getting a new copy next week, hopefully.
So these discs of the 24 Preludes have had a long life.
Yes, they have.
Now, I can imagine what you felt when you learned some of the most difficult music for the piano, and the record company just disappeared.
Can you imagine?
No,
such an awful thing, you know? It was just an evening that I thought I would die, because, you know, it's like having an abortion.
I can understand.
It was just horrible.
Constance Keene is my guest, and we're discussing her 24 Preludes of Rachmaninoff, which will be coming out again in a new issue on Proton Records. Constance, I'm sure that you had a few of these in your fingers, perhaps a couple of the famous ones.
Yes, I did, and that was how I came to do the entire album. Originally, I had done a record for Mercury called The Great Romantic Favorites, and that record had some of the works that are on my new record. Constance Keene Plays a Romantic Tradition, like the Nomenreigen and the Tango of Albanus Godowsky. And in that album, there were also three of the Rachmaninoff preludes. I think it was the D major one, the E flat major, and the E flat minor.
Yes.
And a gentleman by the name of Noel Ferrand happened to hear them when they were played on the radio, and he called me and he asked me whether I would do the Opus 23 for the Rachmaninoff Foundation. Well, I'd never met Mr. Ferrand, and I was not really involved in all the other Rachmaninoff preludes, and I said, well, why don't I take a look at them and see whether or not I think I can ever play them. So for weeks I went over Opus 23, and I thought with enough perspicacity that perhaps I could do them. And then I thought, well, why only do Opus 23? And I called him and I said, but if you're doing all the Rachmaninoff preludes, what about Opus 32? And he said, well, we were planning to get somebody else to do them. And I said, well, then I wouldn't do Opus 23. So he said, well, fine, if you think you'd like to do all of them, then by all means, go ahead. So I learned them all, and I must say it took me a period of about 2 years to do them, because I'm not the kind of person who goes into a record studio and sight reads.
That's anything. What I wanted to hear. Yes, so
I
many people.
I never do that. I never do that, because I prepare for a record session as though I were going to play on the stage. I learn them and learn them and learn them and have many tryouts, and I never go to a record session when I have to read the music. I play everything from memory, and I just play through as though I am giving a concert. I'm not a person who splices. I mean, occasionally, maybe if I've had to make one or two splices in a long work, but that is not my thought when I go to record. I always think that this is a regular performance. And so it takes a great deal more work that way. And I put myself into the frame of mind of communicating to somebody. If it's just the engineer or just a friend of mine, that's okay, but somebody's always present. And that's the reason it took me about 2 years until I decided that I would do it. So by that time, Mr. Ferrand had run out of money, and we never got to do them at all. Then Cap went into the classical record business, and on that occasion, I think Abram Chasins, my husband, and I were doing the two Bach, two piano concerti for them. And they said they were also interested in having Abram do a Chopin album, of which you spoke before, and also my doing the Rachmaninoff preludes. And I think they brought out the Bach, and they brought out his Chopin, and then they said, we've decided not to continue in the classical business. So, too bad. There are the tapes, but we're not going to use them. And that was how I made an arrangement to buy the tapes back from them. And at that time, they had a most marvelous A&R person, Paul Myers.
Sure.
You know, and he had
who still
started
exists.
With, yes, and he's been with Columbia for a long time, but he and Emmanuel Vardy.
Yes.
We were both at the recording sessions.
Mm-hmm.
And we had done those down at RCA Victor with Lewis Lane, who was a great figure for RCA Victor. And I had every bit of the most marvelous cooperation. I mean, you just can't imagine. Because they sat there with me during the blizzard. So I remember we did that in the winter, which made the studio sound wonderful because there was no outside noise that filtered into the studio. And, you know, the street felt as though it was covered in ermine.
Wow.
Gave a lovely kind of
so
sound.
2 years of your life devoted to this grand literature.
Well, I think it's a short time, actually.
Yeah. That's what I wanted to know, because, of course, so many people are given a record assignment. They learn it, and they then piece them together in the studio and so forth. And this is your point of view. Play them as a performance, so there's very little piecing later
yes,
on.
Yes, generally what I do is to make two or three takes, maybe sometimes more if I think the two or three will not sound. I don't stop and listen after each version, but then I listen later on and then generally select the one that I think sounds best.
And you don't mingle the two or three versions usually?
Usually not,
uh-huh.
No. Not when they're short things.
Well, that's very unusual then, you know.
I know that is.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you will find if you are recording that if you try to piece things, they don't always match.
No, they
don't.
Even
if the timing is the same.
Yes.
For example, when we did the last one that has the current Norman Reagan on it,
yes.
There were two versions that we listened to, and there was probably in timing a difference of 2 seconds. But the spirit was so entirely different that even if we had wanted to piece it, we couldn't have possibly done it.
Yes. How interesting.
The spirit never would have matched.
The spirit was different.
One sounded very heavy-handed, and the other sounded with sparkle.
Right within the same
within
context,
the same hour. It's because people who are with me say that seldom do I vary very much in the timing of it. But it's amazing how the spirit can vary. You know, you feel a little fatigued, you feel a little bit let down.
Oh, sure. And then it comes back.
Yeah, and then all of a sudden, you know, you have a regenerated life.
It's a little bit of condensed manic depressive quality, and I think performers have this constantly.
Well, I guess you have to.
Now, you had a lapse in your record career from the Philips World Series until the company Protone, right?
Yes.
Where all of a sudden Constance Keene has had a lyrical outpouring of recordings in the last several years, about 4 or 5.
Well, that happened because I met Jane Cortland Welton, who knew Abram Chasins in California, and she came to town, and she was eager to do something about enhancing her catalog numerically and artistically, and she was very eager to then reissue my Rachmaninoff records. And so I gave her those tapes, and then we went on from there, and she said, well, even though you're not playing very much publicly, why don't you think about doing some recordings? And that's how that started. So I've done about one a year, except I haven't done one this year, but maybe later on in the year we'll do
one. Well, what about that Haydn sonata you played recently? The
I know flat. You're very anxious for me to do that. Yes. And I'm trying to think about, you know, coupling that with something else. So far, all of these records have been of a particular composer.
Maybe a little Haydn, a little Haydn sonata with the big E-flat, and then the second side, Mozart sonatas.
Good idea.
Yeah, perhaps. But anyway, let's now hear from the All Bach album. And although there are original Bach works on this album, we're going to listen to a special work in your repertory. It's very involved because it's the famous organ toccata and fugue in D minor, the Bach Busoni and Bach Tausig, both versions you sort of combined.
Yes, I kind of mixed them up so that it sounds a little more authentic, because the opening in the Tausig is not an authentic opening as far as ornamental practices. So I play what I think would be the original.
So you took the best of these two transcribers,
yes,
and it's now Bach, Tausig, Busoni, and Keene.
Well, I can't say much Keene except for the performance.
The performance is grand, and now we hear Constance Keene in the Toccata and Fugue in D minor of Johann Sebastian Bach. You have heard the grand manner in piano playing, Bach, the way the 19th century conceived of Bach, in the hands of my guest, Constance Keene. And after these words, these messages, I will return with my guest, Constance Keene. Constance, that was a protone album of your playing the Bach Toccata and Fugue in D minor, and as I said just before the messages, that's the grand manner.
Thank you, that's a grand compliment.
Thank you, and that's a grand way of saying that's a grand compliment. But let me say this. Your Bach dances are so stylistically wonderful in the partita. Is there a gap to make one play now stylistically 18th century compared to what that really was, the 19th century concept of Bach?
Well, I think the Toccata and Fugue is quite a different problem in translating it to the piano from what the dances are, because this was originally for the organ,
yes.
And I tried to do this with the organ sonority. Now, when I play the partitas and the French suite, naturally, I think of playing it so that it would be more similar to what one might hear on the harpsichord, but still utilize the piano. I mean, I don't see anything wrong with utilizing a current instrument when that is your medium. But one uses different kinds of touches and different pedaling effects. By the way, I'm not a Bach pianist who never uses the pedal.
Sure.
I touch it ever so lightly now and then, whilst in the Toccata and Fugue much more heavily, and do not hesitate to use a sostenuto pedal mm-hmm. when I play the Toccata and Fugue. I know
sure.
there are many people who frown on that. You know, they think that since there was no sostenuto pedal on any piano in Bach's time, why should we use it? But I think that you should use everything that is at your disposal. And I don't think it would be possible to have an organ sonority without sustaining those low bass notes.
You, as a pianist, are a very slender person, and yet your sonority is vast. You don't bang. Is there a way you do that? Is it relaxation? Because it's certainly not force. I've seen you play in public.
Mm-hmm. Well, I go on the principle that I was taught, and that is that the motion and rest principle, or tension-relaxation principle, is ever-present, so that I go with the line or the phrase as I conceive it. And also, what I do is try to use all of my body weight. It's not a matter of simply using my fingers or my arms.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you sit up straight at the instrument and you use all of yourself and you lean your entire weight into the keyboard, you get a very powerful sound. It's not a banging sound, but you're really leaning your entire weight into the keyboard, and you're thinking of the keyboard as a place of rest. Now, you know, there are many people who don't think about resting into the keyboard. In fact, they lean back. And to withhold weight makes you very tense. The more you relax, the more sound you get, the more sonority you get. Of course, everything is dependent on the kind of sound that you wish to produce.
Now, in the next work, we'll hear the Gnomenregen. What are you after in this Dance of the Gnomes by Liszt?
Well, I'm after a very sprightly sound, tremendous clarity, tremendous air spaces. I hope that you'll be able to hear them.
It's a little devil of a work, isn't it?
Exactly, exactly.
I always think
it's very puckish,
as Mendelssohn turned diabolical.
I think you've said it all.
Let's now hear Constance Keene in her protone album, which contains the Gnomenregen, the Dance of the Gnomes, concert etude by Franz Liszt.
Thank you.
know, Constance, how you play that piece now with verve and virtuosity. That is a little killer of a technical wizardry there.
That's lifetimes of work.
One little piece.
And 2 minutes and something, right?
Yes, 256 mm-hmm. is a life. That's it.
It really is. I mean, that's something that you absolutely have to practice all your life. And even when you think that you really know how to play it, you have to sit down and do it several more hours.
I think that very few people understand, if they're not pianists, what kind of heartache it is, in the nicest sense of a heartache, if that can be nice. It's never ending, the battle, and one day off, the fingers might not work, and you have to play for thousands of people. It's endless,
well, it's
isn't
a very
it?
Demanding profession, if you have standards.
Yeah.
And unless you have standards, you shouldn't be playing in public
now,
or recording.
Let's say you're working on this for the record, and the record is done. And a month later, of course, the pieces fall in from your fingers in a way. You have to redo it, right?
Well, you have to revamp things. I wouldn't say that any of these things really fall from my fingers because I practice, I think, pretty intelligently. I was very fortunate when I was young to have had the most marvelous instruction. I've never had a teacher who ever was a poor teacher. Every one of my hours of instruction was invaluable.
Who were
and
some
it was
of your
always
teachers?
Going ahead. Well, I had a marvelous teacher when I was a child by the name of Catherine Macon, whom I don't think anybody knows. And then I studied with her daughter, Mrs. Leffler, who again was unknown, but they were both superb. And then I met Abram shortly thereafter through one of my high school music teachers who insisted that he hear me play. And he resisted for a long time, but anyway, finally gave in. And I don't think he liked my playing particularly at that time, but decided that what was the difference? I was going to be a pianist, so he might as well undertake helping me. But during that period, I also studied with a fantastic woman, Mrs. Lotta Mills Huff. And she helped me tremendously in gaining my mechanical equipment.
Now, how? How?
Now, how? We did chanting exercises from morning until night. She was a Leschetitskyite.
Uh-huh.
And I
meaning she was in Vienna studying with that man.
Yes, and she had for years, and she was one of his best pupils. And she knew all his little secrets about how to practice just pure finger passages, how to practice thirds, how to practice sixths, how to practice octaves. And at each session, we would devote ourselves to a particular problem at the keyboard. And I would then do an exercise that would be an example of whatever we were working on. And I had to prepare those etudes as though they were written by Chopin or Liszt. And when I came in for a lesson, they were to be played from memory at an excessive tempo, yes, and as though I was playing a concert performance of those works. And she was absolutely unyielding in the sense that if you made a mistake, she'd just carry on and say, I can see you have not practiced this week. And half the time I was dissolved in tears.
You were just
I
a
don't
child.
Do very
how old
I was
by
about
then.
13. Mm-hmm. And however, I value those sessions enormously because they really showed me how to practice and also showed me how to get to a point in a piece that perhaps might be a problem point and to just do something about that particular problem, not to go back to the beginning of the piece, because as she used to say, if you go back to the beginning of the piece, it will only make the beginning better. It won't correct the difficulty. And then she would show me how to kind of make that into a situation that was, you know, like a chain. You attach that measure to the measure that precedes it and the one that follows it. And I've always been able, therefore, to be able to practice in a much shorter time than most people because I can instantly see the problem and know how to go about handling it.
And that's what makes you one of the eminent piano teachers in New York.
Well, I try to advise my pupils in that fashion. I don't just assume that a lesson is come in and play something for me and okay, you can play it a little faster or a little slower or you haven't prepared your studies. If we have a problem, we really try to outline it. Even though when you're teaching in a school, as I do at the Manhattan School of Music, it is sometimes difficult to be that detailed because, you know, you have maybe 15 hours during a semester, and that's not a whole lot of time, particularly when you're involved with people who are in a conservatory situation and want themselves to be public performers. And I have so many of the doctoral candidates at school, too, so that means we have a great deal of repertoire to cover in a very short time. But I really always stop and try to handle the problem, no matter what kind of problem it is, even sometimes psychiatric.
Well, the great teacher is the great psychologist.
Yes, you just have to be.
Yes. So then you had intelligent teaching, which made you an intelligent practicer. When you got to Abram Chazen's, I'm sure that this man who's so full of musical ideas opened up a whole new aspect musically for you?
Oh, it was completely new world. I just, you know, couldn't believe what was happening to me. Because I met Abram when I was 13, and I received a scholarship in a master class that he was giving. And I was the youngest person present. And it was a class for both performers and auditors. And it eventuated that of the four afternoons of week that the classes took place, I played three of them. And really, I used to sit up all night to prepare for the next day, but I never was so excited about music in my life, and I never was so fascinated by all the ideas that I heard, because it was a totally different kind of, you know, instruction or enlightenment from what I'd ever had before. I couldn't believe, you know, this was possible.
So excitement was instilling you now.
Yes, such an inspiration.
Well, Abram Chazen's has a tremendous tradition behind him. The next piece you'll play, The Swan, by Saint-Saëns, of course, is for cello from The Carnival of Animals, but it is transcribed by the legendary Gudovsky, who Abram certainly knew.
Very well.
Yes, and and still is in awe of, I think.
Oh, I think probably every great pianist feels that way.
Isn't it quite amazing that from around 1920 till 1980, he still remains a legend?
Yes, and so many people are playing his music.
Now, what do you think of his music? On this protone, you have a...
I have the swan, and I have the tango, and on another record, I had done the Triana of Albanus in the Gudovsky version, and I had actually done one of the Bach cello sonatas as transcribed by Gudovsky, and I must tell you that all his transcriptions are so beautiful, and they are so complicated, to the point that I would say that if you alter a fingering in performance, you can be hopelessly askew.
And even in a work as slow-moving as The Swan, it must be the same.
It is. It's true, yes.
It's so full of webs. Does the audience ever really know what the pianist...
I don't think they ever realize it.
This
no,
is pianist's music,
really,
even the simplest of it.
Yes, only the pianists recognize the difficulty.
Let's hear your performance of the Gudovsky transcription of The Swan. Gorgeous, dreamy, serpentine, contrapuntal forms. Constance, will you wait for me when I return in 1 minute after these messages? This is David Dubal and my guest today, Constance Keene, and we are going through her albums very slowly because there are many titles, and it's been my privilege to hear her play The Swan. We early in the program discussed her Rachmaninoff preludes, and I think, Constance, we talked enough about them. I think we should hear from that album a piece you're very fond of, the E-flat minor prelude, correct?
Yes, that's the one all in double notes.
Yes. I once practiced that piece, and I think you'll understand it, and I overdid it, and my right hand was paralyzed for a week.
Oh, that's too bad. Then you should have just practiced the left hand alone where the beautiful melodic line
exists. I have no discipline. The right hand was gone, and you know, that was it for me.
And that stopped it.
Yeah. Let's now hear Constance in the magnificent double notes of the Rachmaninoff E-flat minor prelude. One of the most difficult double note preludes in the literature of the piano, and it was a magnificent performance by Constance Keene. The only time I have really ever heard the climax the way you understand this,
yes,
Connie? That I like it, and I want now to hear it again. Do you mind?
Oh, I'd love to have you do it.
Thank you. Constance Keene playing the Rachmaninoff Prelude in E-flat minor. Constance, do you mind if I go to King Carol's? I hope they're there, at least.
Oh, I hope so, but they usually carry all of my records.
Great, because I must have, and I don't have in my permanent collection, these Rachmaninoff Preludes, which are just so wonderful. I'll be back in about an hour. I have to go to King Carol's. Right after this message, I'll return with more talk with Constance Keene, my guest. We've played Bach, we've played Liszt, we've played Godovsky Saint-Saëns, we have played Rachmaninoff, and now let's conclude this program, the first of two programs with you, Constance, in a performance dear to you. How could you describe this? This is a fantasy on the opera Schwanda. The opera is not known except for a couple of excerpts, and Abram Chazens, your husband, transcribed it into an unreal fantasy. It's delicious.
A fantastic fantasy.
It is, isn't
you call
it?
It really a virtuosic
but
tour de force.
He had Godovsky in his mind and all of that labyrinth, didn't he?
Yes, absolutely. Actually, he wrote that piece for me when I made my New York debut when I won the Naumburg. I was then studying with both Abram and Mrs. Huff, to whom I referred previously, and she said to him, Abram, why don't you write a wonderful end piece for Constance? And he said, well, like what? And she said, why don't you do it on the Schwanda fantasy? And that's how it came into being. I have never recorded it until this particular recording, although Abram had recorded it in the past. And when I told him I was going to do it, he had completely forgotten that he'd written it for me. And he said, oh, do you know that piece at all? It's awfully hard to learn. I said, oh, I think it's still somewhat in my memory and I can revise it. So I did.
How charming. And you revised it into your fingers again and into your heart and now onto a ProTone album. And it's on the transcription album that we heard the Swan and the Nomenregen from, right?
Mm-hmm, right.
Let's hear your performance of the Schwanda Fantasy, Weinberger, Chazens.
Thank you.
Fun to Fantasy in a transcription of those tunes by Abram Chasins, of course the opera by Weinberger, and the performer Constance Keene in her newest album of transcriptions on Protone. And we have had, Constance, a little travelogue of your four or five newest LPs.
And I hope there'll be more coming.
And you know that very shortly we'll be having another program where you'll be speaking in depth about other pianistic problems, teaching, and so forth, and we'll be hearing more of your recordings very shortly.
Good. I look forward to coming back to being with you.
Thank you, Constance. And this is David Dubal for The Love of Music.
For The Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company. Thank you.